one of the topics we actually didn't cover as a direct lecture, okay, was how to fix asymmetries. Now listen, some of you guys are advanced bodybuilders. And the thing is, if you take the most advanced bodybuilders and you were to take their body and like put it inside of, I don't know, what do you use, Fernando? Adobe, you know, what do you
Photoshop.
Use? Photoshop, okay? I have no idea. So he used Photoshop. And if Fernando were to take an advanced bodybuilder and he were to cleave the left side of a bodybuilder from the right side, and I were to show you that on separate occasions, you wouldn't recognize that it was the same person. Even the most advanced bodybuilders have large asymmetries between the right side and the left side. So we didn't cover, well, how do you fix that? Now, it just so happens that Charlie is actually finished the study, but on a method to fix those asymmetries, okay? So so basically, I think, and he's gonna get into that study, but actually, you know, I'm gonna let you talk about what was the creative method that we used to attack asymmetries?
Yeah, so I think we wanna talk about a little bit, almost of a literature review of sorts of like, we know bodybuilders have these asymmetries, and more often than not, it's towards the dominant side. Their dominant side's bigger, stronger. And this is really pretty common in sports research, especially soccer, sometimes volleyball. A lot of these sports where you're gonna be stronger on the dominant side because you use the dominant side more. And so what we're finding in a lot of these studies is greater neural drive or force production, better range of motion, all these things that favor the dominant side as opposed to the non-dominant side. And so, over the years, research has tried to do a few things to mitigate that. You know, it's unilateral loading, balance training, doing, you know, lifting on BOSU balls and stupid stuff like that. But nothing's ever had long-term outcomes. We're just looking at muscle activation, joint kinetics, stuff like that. So last year, one interesting study and one poorly done study about offset loading, which is essentially, it's only been done in the bench press. We have to figure out, you know, how to do it in other exercises. But if you're benching a barbell, essentially adding just a little bit of weight onto one side or the other. And so the studies that came out last year, and we even did a pilot study on this. We never published it.
Yeah.
We didn't have enough people. But the studies that came out last year were finding that offsetting that load towards the non-dominant side essentially led to even symmetry between the pecs, the delts, and the triceps in the bench press. And so, obviously, research and strength training, people don't fund long-term studies very often.
Yeah.
So we basically take this and say, hey, we saw symmetrical muscle activation. We think you'll get symmetrical gains from it.
Yeah.
So essentially, we gathered up that data and said, hey, let's do a long-term study on this and see what happens.
Yeah.
So we had two groups of people bench pressing, 10 or 11 guys in each, all mid-20s. Well, some guys were in their 30s, I guess, but they all benched 250 pounds, give or take, so they're decently strong.
Yeah.
We had one group just do normal bench press training for 4 weeks, and the other group did offset loading for 4 weeks. And so each group did 5 sets of bench. Week one, you did 12, then 10, then, you know, you worked your way down to get some sort of periodization scheme going. So the group that did offset loading, they would have it randomized. So 1 week, you might have a left offset, a right offset. You might go back and forth. Sometimes you do two towards one side, two towards the other side. Your first 4 sets are randomized. So you're getting randomly offset loading towards one side or the other. And then your final set is just a symmetrically loaded normal bench press. So we tested that. We had them perform that for 4 weeks. We did that twice a week. And then we did tons of post-testing, EMG, muscle thickness with the ultrasound. We tested their bench press max. We assessed how hard they were training during, how hard they felt like they were training. Ridiculous amounts of data on this. It was insane.
It was insane.
So then we took 2 weeks to crunch the numbers probably,
least.
Yeah. You know, and basically what we found after all of that was that offset loading worked. We had better strength gains in offset loading, 60% better strength gains in 4 weeks. So in 4 weeks, guys that were benching 250 pounds on average added almost 20 pounds to their bench press max doing this. I can't.
That's a lot of
weight. The last time any of my lifts went up by 20 pounds.
Yeah, that's a lot of weight.
That takes years.
These are strong guys. You guys are stronger than 90%,
right.
98% of the studies that are out there.
Right. And so, I mean, that's massive, massive gains. Any the other groups still put on, I think, 10 or 11 pounds, and it's not bad. I mean, it shows the bench press program itself worked.
It does.
But the cool thing is that we tested muscle thickness of the pecs, the left and the right pec, and the offset group A made better gains in general, way better gains in general, like 50% better gains in both pecs. B, the standard or normal loading group, the group that did normal bench press, had asymmetrical pec development. I think one pec was developed like 53% more than the other one.
Yeah,
the gains they made.
Yeah,
it was insane.
Better gains in the not dominant.
And the group that did offset loading diminished that result by 50%, essentially. Mm-hmm. So I think there was a 53% difference in the normal group and only a 26% difference in the offset group. And remember, in that offset group, we randomized the offset. So we didn't do all offsetting to the non-dominant side.
Yeah.
So that leaves us another study we can do in the future.
Right.
But number two, just offsetting two of those five sets, that non-dominant side, we reduced the asymmetry by 50%.
Yep.
Which is awesome.
We did.
And they got stronger and better gains in general. So I mean, this is something that nobody's ever done before.
No one's ever done this before, and I think that's the coolest part. Look, we do all these lectures and things like this, but one of the big reasons why we got in this field is we wanted to advance it by doing research. So it's always an exciting thing when you can test something new. And that's the other thing is you guys might go out and do that too. You don't know. Anyone can do research to an extent. Mm-hmm. And you guys certainly have a working knowledge. But this is actually very powerful stuff. So think about this, guys. When have you offset loaded? Everyone's offset loaded, right? It's when we think we're being dumb. So, you know, let's say that you go underneath the bench press and like on one side you put like a 10 and you're not thinking and you put a 5 on the other side. It's by accident. And you take the weight off, you're like, oh, damn it. And what do? You re-rack it, okay? And then you readjust the weight, and when you take it off, it still feels weird, even though you readjusted it, right? So normally you think, oh, I messed up. We did this on purpose, okay? And it actually worked. So again, it's really cool stuff because going to the original study, when you take this non-dominant pec and putting that slight variation on it actually increased the activation, you hypothesized it's going to increase growth. We didn't know that it did. Mm-hmm. Now, other things that I thought, you know, were interesting about this study were like people, think about it. If you've been benching for a long time, I'm sure a lot of you guys have, or squatting, when you're benching, are you thinking at all about bench pressing? Do you have really high mental effort? Not from a skill perspective, right? Mm-hmm. So these people, like they're mentally, at least visually, what happened like to their perceived exertion and their mental effort?
Yeah, I mean, it's like you said, most of us, you go to the gym, bench press is second nature by now.
Yeah.
Like you lay down, oh, I'm benching again. But this is something, I mean, you think back to the first time you bench pressed, hopefully most people had somebody teach them how.
Yeah.
I didn't. I remember the first time I unracked a bench press, I dropped it on my neck.
Yeah, me too.
Because I was trying to max out. Nobody told me how to do it.
Right.
But nowadays, I think, you know, people are at least showing each other how to do it. But the first time, the first couple times you bench press, you unrack it and you're really thinking about, okay, I'm going to keep my elbows close. I need to touch this point on my chest. I need to reach that part on the ceiling. You're really thinking about what you're doing. Not anymore.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just like, does this hurt or not?
Exactly.
But when we offset load, we're changing that loading pattern, and now we're making people think about it again. We're thinking about, we still want them to balance the bar, because obviously you offset load, you could just shift the load to compensate. We weren't letting them do that.
You know.
So we're thinking about, now, again, it's, you know, tracing that bar path, keeping the bar centered on yourself, gripping the bar, they're rethinking about how to bench press. And so, not only is this, you know, a training overload, you know, it's a different loading pattern, a new neuromotor skill, but we're also mentally overloading them.
Yeah.
They're having to rethink about how to train.
Yeah.
And that showed in the data.
And that's how you make improvements. That's the thing, when you look at, people just think about bench pressing as being strong, but bench pressing is a skill. it is a skill, okay? And people who are highly effective bench pressers are highly skilled at the bench press. But if you plateau in your skill when you stop thinking about it. And so what motor learning tells us is that the more you're overloading the brain, the more rapid your learning response. Again, think about when you first started training. Oh my God, you were learning and making adaptations all the time. So this forced you kind of back into that learning stage of things. And that, I think that contributed to the outcomes of strength. Now, Charlie, why in this study did we select, what percent did we choose to offload and why did we decide to use that?
We did 5%. And I know in the pilot study, that was just kind of a random number we chose, yeah. You know. And the study we kind of loosely based our design off of chose 2.5%, 5%, and 7.5% as the offloads they tested. And 2.5% alone made a difference. 5% was a little more, 7.5% was a little more beyond that. So we just went in the middle because we knew from previous data that it should work. B, choosing that 5% still gives us opportunities in the future to try 7.5, 10, 2.5. We can still try other stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
But right. You know, essentially, if you hate doing math, which most people do, for the most part, if you're benching somewhere between 1 and 200 pounds, throw an extra 5 on your non-dominant side of the bar. If you're between 2 and 300 pounds, throw an extra 10 on. You know, that's the easiest way to do it.
Because that's what I've done.
We were stuck in this position where we had this whole spreadsheet of exactly what it had to be.
Yeah.
Because you think about, it's 5%, so it's 150 pounds. Say you're using 150 pounds, 5% of that's 7.5 pounds. But it's not taking 7.5 from one side and putting on the other, because now it's a 10% offset.
Yeah.
You have to take 2.5% from one side and add it to the other. So we were stuck with all these spreadsheets. We had half pound weights. I mean, we were getting as close as possible to this. I wouldn't do that in the gym.
No.
I'd slap another 5 on or slap another 10 on. It's probably gonna be somewhere in that 5 to 7.5% range, or even the 2.5 to 7.5% range. All of it works.
Yep.
And I think that's the easiest takeaway for someone. Just slap an extra plate on there.
It is.
A small plate.
Exactly, a small plate. 5 or a 10, yeah. Like Charlie says. So again, so that's the one thing. Now, here's the thing. In our study, we balanced the offset it was balanced. And overall in the study, they had just as many times on the non-dominant side as the dominant side. We still saw better gains in the non-dominant side. But there's things that can be done in the future that we can do studies on. For example, if you know that you have a high asymmetry, and maybe it's your biceps or something like that, your left bicep is just way smaller than your right. Maybe you do a 2-to-1 ratio for a month where you offset that side at a 2-to-1 ratio. We don't know this, but we're saying that this be potentially something that you can try out when you have a high asymmetry as opposed to just unilateral training. You might offset that side at a 2-to-1 ratio for a month and see. Also, we still did traditional training. So you basically did, if you did do 5 sets, 4 of them were offset and 1 of them was traditional, okay? And man, I'm telling you, like, you're gonna notice a difference, man. And it's like your triceps are gonna feel like thicker and a bigger pump. Your pecs are gonna feel like they have a bigger pump. Your delts. I did it on military press the other day.
Oh,
yeah.
You're a madman.
Yeah.
That sounds terrible.
And I'm telling you though, my delts, like, it was one of the best pumps I've gotten in my delts in a long time. So. Guys, I'm telling you right now, so if your last homework assignment is on your next workout, offset load it.
Yeah, you know? Seriously.